Oh my.
I'm practicing my steps.
You're doing an excellent job. Oh, you look great.
Thanks, Dad. You look sharp.
Thank you.
The dress is beautiful.
Thank you.
And it fits very well. It's almost like it was made for you.
It's almost like it was made for me. Oh.
It's pretty awesome. I was just noticing your dress twirl with our dancing. I'm all the way over here.
Can we do it? Yeah. Okay. Can we do a twirl?
We can. Look at that. Wow.
We can.
The dress continues to twirl.
Slow down.
You look great, honey.
Sorry, so. I'm going back for a retouch up.
They just love each other. You don't have to say
Hi. We gotta turn this way.
Oh, okay.
You look amazing.
Oh, thank you.
God,
so
love,
do you.
I love your hair.
Thanks.
How much makeup am I getting on?
Nothing.
Nothing?
You're good.
So
you're not even
dress.
Red.
This is so. This is hard work. So
it's hard work.
Are you excited?
Yeah.
Oh, this is gonna be something.
There'll be spin trouble.
Give me the dance buzz.
Okay. We got it. I think we're good.
Yeah. This is wow. Great.
Thanks, what do you?
Look how sharp you guys look. I'm so
thank you. I'm entrusting her to you. I'm
so happy.
I'm happy. I'm sure you're going to be a very good husband to her.
Thank you. You may all be seated. Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Spencer Tepe. I'm Madeline's big brother, and it is a true honor to stand here and conduct this ceremony today. On behalf of the two families, I'd like to sincerely thank everyone for being here today, your attendance and participation on the dance floor, regardless of the wind, is your most important gift. We're here today in a favorite spot of the couple to offer our support as these two join hands in holy matrimony. Obviously, this decision is a big one. However, seeing as you've had 7 years to think about it, I'm gonna go out on a limb here and consider you guys ready. With that being said, let's take a moment and reflect on how all this came to be. Madeline and Rob met 7 years ago on a fall day, probably like this one, at the University of Cincinnati. In a twist of fate, they were paired up in competition and quickly hit it off. Now, it's difficult to say exactly what led to their initial spark, but Madeline may say it was her appreciation for a fine tailored chino. Others may argue that it was their combined talents behind the beer pong table, but whatever it was, they began to spend time together. Are we gonna keep going? Yeah. Are we on? Okay.
Keep going.
And memories quickly accumulated for these two. I've got a list here. There were late night debates. There were hangouts at the fraternity house. There were belly flop championships. I encourage you all to ask Madeline about this later. Evidently, these two were always the best dressed at Halloween. We saw a number of those photos yesterday evening. And then, of course, there were trips to Uncle Woody's and to Skyline. Now, some of you may not yet know, but the Mislav family owns some Skyline restaurants. And quite honestly, I've never seen or met someone with an appetite for Skyline quite like this guy. Fortunately, Madeline likes Skyline just as much. I'm not sure we'd be standing up here otherwise today. I can only imagine how many times these two woke up after a long weekend and drove to Skyline together. Two three-ways, one cheese coney, onions mustard, yeah. Two chilitos, no onion. If you guys haven't tried the chilitos yet, it's worth it. Skyline is now part of their bond. It's part of their story. Yes, whatever it was that drew these two together initially, I know for a fact that they were surrounded by support from the very beginning. They fell in love in the very best company, each other's, their friends, and their families. Fast forward. It didn't take long before Rob was sitting across the table at Tepe Christmas. Not gonna lie, the guy fit right in. The kid was cruising through Aunt Candy's family interrogations like it was two-line layups at Madeira High. We knew he'd be back. And sure enough, there he was. Year after year, Sis kept bringing him around. Their love for each other became increasingly evident. Their relationship matured. They grew together. They made a home together, / leather factory. And they raised a dog together. I'm always impressed by how easy they make it look. More strikingly, how often they make it look good. No surprise for two artists in love. Upon graduation, Madeline chose to ignore convention and follow her heart. Inspired by great-grandpa, pants guru, and her spirit animal, she began to build a brand. Her effort has seen countless nights of conceptualizing, production, and business stuff. Inevitably, some joked when she'd throw in the towel. But not Bob. Not to me, at least. Madeline is pursuing her passion. And while progress ebbs and flows, Rob's support does not. My favorite is when we arrive at their place and we get up to the door and we're knocking. And knocking quickly turns into pounding, but no answer. It turns out, at least up until recently, Madeline has her own studio now, that Madeline was pounding and shaping leather so often that Rob had become completely desensitized to all loud noises. That's patience. That's support. That's love. Roberts, upon graduation, took a job at Pure Romance as media coordinator. From day one, Rob's travel schedule has been a little crazy. They go days, sometimes weeks, without seeing each other, but Madeline's support has not wavered. As a once kick-butt, high-flying cheerleader, Madeline always seems to find a way to cheer on her true love. And Rob, a man of many talents, never hesitates to pick up the pom-poms and root for his favorite girl. They are each other's biggest fans. Madeline and Robert, I've had the pleasure of watching you two grow together as a couple. Your experiences thus far have become the foundation upon which you can build your new home together, brick by brick. You two are the most crucially important structures. You two are the load-bearing beams. Now, I want you to take a moment and peer out onto your guest. You see him?
I see him.
This half.
Madeline and Robert, everything the light touches is your family. We are your insulation. We are your roof when you visit. We are your electric when you need a spark of spontaneity. We are your kitchen when you need a family meal or some Sunday soup and a game of Catan. We are not your plumbing. We are your family, and we will always be here for you. And I think that's what completes you two. I think that's what brings it all together. Because you two chose to build your home and lives with us, and we most certainly will do the same with you. Now, before we make it official, I'd like to quickly reflect on the evolution of this relationship. Christmas 2011. Robert's most infamous family nickname is conceived. Courtesy of Grandma Kate, he is dubbed Chili Boy.
This is awesome, baby.
Grandma forgets names sometimes. 2012, the expected Rob. 2013, the sarcastic yet heartfelt Bob. And 2014, after meeting Cam and Sherry, we were introduced to Robbie. But that's all behind us now. Rob, today you become a husband, a son-in-law, and my brother. I couldn't have picked a better brother, nor could Madeline have selected a better husband. and Madeline. Well, what can I say? You were once upon a time my favorite person to annoy. But look at us now. I'm so lucky and happy to consider you one of my closest friends and to have you as my sister.
Right back at you.
Congratulations, guys. We're all so very happy for you. At this time, we invite Grandpa Lou to share a reading, and then we'll get to the vows.
Technically, I'm only Bob's grandpa, but Maddie has called me grandpa for so long, I consider her a real granddaughter. Today, it'll be legitimate. When Bob and Maddie asked me to do a reading, excuse my voice, I told them I would be honored. Maddie then told me I could choose anything I wanted, except the biblical verse that says, wives, obey your husbands. That's out. My daughter, the Hungarian queen, wanted me to read from the Bible, Ruth, whither thou goest, I will go. Your people will be my people. I think that's always done. Then I thought of times I saw Maddie and Rob sitting on a sofa, pretending to watch TV. Excuse me. I wondered what they might be saying to each other. That brought to mind one of my favorite hymns. This reading is an adaptation of that hymn. I could see Rob and Maddie saying these words to each other. Great is my faithfulness to you. You do not change over time. Your compassions do not leave you. As you have been, you forever will be. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and
stars in their courses above, join with all nature to witness my faithfulness and love. Your own dear presence cheers and guides me. You give me strength for today and hope for tomorrow. 10,000 blessings are mine and more are to come. Morning by morning, all I have needed, you have provided. Great is my faithfulness to you.
Thanks, Joe. Bless you.
Thank you.
All right. Okay, so we've got the rings now. These rings symbolize an eternal commitment to one another. Cherish them as you cherish each other, and always remember that in the end, the love you receive is only equal to the love you give. Madeline and Robert chose to write their own vows. Robert, you're up.
Hold that for me. Let me adjust my hair here. Madeline, I never get that right. I vow to be there for you with loving and open arms during your most emotionally delicate moments. Like when Walter decides he's done cuddling and jumps off the couch. I'll be there, I'll be second in line, but I'll be there. I promise to always be your beer pong partner, even though I may have lost a step or two since our first game on the night we met over 7 years ago. I vow to always share a unique sense of humor, and I promise not to silence you when you're trying to explain inside jokes to other people who just don't get it. Sorry, my hair is crazy. I vow to be more like you, an individual everyone can learn from, someone who is tender and caring, cunning and creative, in the moment and spontaneous, transparent and honest, patient and calming, careful and coordinated. Scratch that last one. I vow to be your eyes and ears when I can tell from afar that you're about to knock something over. I promise to attempt to keep my mouth shut while you're driving, but for God's sakes, please pay more attention, please. Finally, I vow to continue our journey together, enjoying both the small steps and major milestones that life has in store. I will always encourage you, and you already know I'm always going to tell you what I think, even if it's not what you want to hear. While this may lead to some arguments, just know that it is rooted in love. My faith in you is stronger than you can ever know, and I will believe in you when you don't believe in yourself. While I've known for years that you would be my wife, I stand here today, giddy and excited to begin the next stage in our lives. I think I lost the ring.
Oh, phew. Oh, okay.
It has to be kind of close, sorry.
From the minute I met you, I was instantly smitten. Over the last 7 years, that feeling has grown into deep love, immense respect, and genuine admiration. And I'm still pretty darn smitten. I've had the pleasure of getting to grow up with you, and I've watched you grow into such a handsome, hardworking, charismatic individual. Some might say you're a top shelf guy. And that's not just because you can reach the top of any shelf. Though I love that about you too. You are kind, caring, and loyal, and you make loving you easy as you're my favorite person and my very best friend. Today, in front of our friends and family, I want to make you several promises. I promise to love and care for you and to do my best to be worthy of your love in every way. I promise to be kind and patient, to be your student and your teacher. I promise to encourage and nurture your dreams, but I promise to remind you how great you already are. I promise to always remember the sacrifices you've made for my dreams and to show you how grateful I am. I promise to be strong when you're in need and to turn to you in times of need. I promise to be your teammate and to do my fair share of offense and defense. Also, I promise to hustle. And by that, I really just mean I'm gonna try to be on time. I promise to indulge in late night discussions and spirited debates. And I promise to celebrate the good times with you and love you through the difficult times, always remembering that as long as we have each other, we will always have more than we need. You are my best friend, my companion, my lover, and my partner. You are the Jim to my Pam. I like you and I love you, and I can't wait to go on this adventure with you as my wife. I love you. Or as...
I'm not going to be your wife.
Your wife.
I will be your wife.
There's something you don't know.
Oh, there's not. You guys ready?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. By the power invested in me in the great state of Ohio, I now pronounce you husband and wife. Rob, you may kiss the bride. Ladies and gentlemen, for the very first time, I introduce Mr. and Mrs. Mizla.
ladies and gentlemen, we'll be getting started with a toast shortly.
These are only the hardcore people who stayed tonight. Madeline and Rob. All right. After a brief tornado. All right. Turn it up. Turn it on. Turn it on. Okay, we got it. Are you up here to say something? Do you want to say something? You were starting to stand. To stand. Okay. I want to thank all of you for enduring that wind event. I think that's what we'll call it. It was just a wind event. And you guys are tough that you stayed. I mean, maybe there's some shattered glass cuts. But thank you for staying. Now, I do have a warm-up act. Mr. Frank has traditionally entertained the crowd. He's warmed up the crowd. He's going to, and we really do need a warm-up act. So, Kenny.
Thank you very much, Mr. Tebby. All right, so wind event that Mr. Tepe has just described. Sounds like a new Winnebago, doesn't it? Hey, we got the Winnebago wind event. You know, when you're driving down the highway, you got this wind event. Hey, it doesn't blow in the wind. But anyhow, so we're gonna do one quick little joke that I have. My jokes, for a wedding party, I gotta cut back a little bit. So it doesn't offend anyone. While Tim gets his notes ready here. Louder, louder, louder! All right. So what we have here is a little bit of a, and I'm trying to remember, it's a little bit of a joke, so a little boy, which you guys will have someday. To carry on that Musla name, and Chili Boy, Chili Child, or whatever we're going to call him. Chili Child. So, Rob's up walking through the house one day, and he sees his son. He said, hey, God bless mommy, daddy, grandma and grandpa, and goodbye, muffin. Doesn't think much about it. Next day, they wake up and muffin, the family dog is dead. Oh, bad, 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 bad news. So, a couple days passes by, and it's probably not a good joke for this. But anyhow, okay. Go ahead.
Wow. Wow, Kenny. Thank you for that. That's a hard act to follow. But I'm going to try. So, you know, before I... Before I get started, and I really sort of envisioned this whole, I thought a lot about this speech and I envisioned it differently. Hello. But for those of you who don't know, I'm Tim Tepe, I'm the father of the bride. I've been through hard duty tonight. I think I'm gonna get a medal. But I want to start with some thank yous. And if the parent who was responsible for this event was up here doing this speech, it would be Yvonne. I was mostly a spectator at this event. And I would talk to my friend, how's the wedding going? Well, you know, I don't know. I mean, I'm just, Yvonne's doing it. And they would laugh with me, mostly the guys. They'd say, well, you know, your job is just to write the checks. You know, that's what you do. So Yvonne came up to me a week ago and she goes, I wrote all the checks, so everybody's paying. So I didn't even do that. But there are other people, of course, to thank here. I want to thank, I don't think it's legal to have a wedding without having showers. So I want to thank Tina. Tina had the Tepe Magliano shower. I want to thank Sherry. Sherry and Gina had the Misla shower, Chisno shower. Kathy Dunford, where is she? Had the friends and neighbors shower. There she is. Very nice, all of you. Spencer, I want to thank. So, you know, Spencer and I are riding around the car yesterday, and I'm driving, you know, and he's just sitting there going, and he's mumbling out his speech that he's going to do today. And he goes, what do you think about this? What do you think about that? The man worked very hard to give his presentation. So thank you. I thought you did a great job. I want to thank all the friends and neighbors who helped us put this together. You brought over stuff. I mean, if you fell down and skinned your knee and went into the bathroom, Don O'Connor brought Band-Aids and other things. So if you're ill or have trouble, all the people, some people just dropped off the bottle of wine going, you're going to need this to help us plan. Mike and Patty Hensley came over. Mike Hensley. And Patty, Mike was putting those keys together. I know you're going to keep those for the rest of your life. It's going to be great. I want to thank Callie Evans. Callie, where are you? Callie? You left. All right, I'm not thanking you then. Nah. Callie Evans worked in partnership with Madeline to make this dress. 700 hours of dressmaking. I hope she doesn't divide the hours by her fee. I might have violated some minimum wage laws. But she did that. And mostly, I want to thank Sherry and Cam Mislam. They, for everything they did, they put on the party last night, the rehearsal dinner, the after party. They helped us, please stand up. They helped us with tonight. It's great. And if the wind hasn't blown Skyline away, maybe they'll show up later. So, I'm really excited. I've never really invited 300 people to dinner tonight in one night. And it's good that maybe 200 stayed, but 300 showed up, and we invited 350 people, and 6 out of 7 came. So 350 we invited, 300 accepted and came. And they didn't come to see me, and they didn't come to see you, I'm afraid. In fact, I thought about that, you know, what would get, hold on, who came? All right, thank you. All right, thank you. It's one. But you think about what gets people to come to an event, and I thought, you know, maybe if I had called my sister Terry, I'm just gonna use her as an example, and she lives down in Dallas, and I would say, Terry, I want you to come up. I'm having a big party. It's going to be like there's going to be a hurricane, which is going to be nice. But there's going to be food. There's going to be drink. There's going to be a dancing band, maybe. Not really, as it turns out. But I want you and Dana and Joe, I want you to, you know, go spend $1,000 and just come up for this party. Buy some plane tickets. And she would, what's the event? And I would go, there's no event. Who's going to be there? Mostly people you don't know. And I guarantee you she would have turned me down. If I had said it was my birthday, she would go, you're 58. I'm not coming up for 58. And if I said 60, she would think about it. She'd give me the slow no, and then she wouldn't come. She'd give me the slow no. But if I say it's a wedding, and I say it's Madeline, you're gonna come. Tell you the date, you'll be there. And Dana looked at me like, he goes, I wouldn't miss it for the world. And that's the power of a wedding. And that's the power. People are here to see you too. And they've all come, and some people, they've all come to see you too. And I don't think there's any way we get this many people together in a windstorm to come and see the two of you. So, yes, yes, we did not put on the invitation, hurricane expected. So hang in there. Yeah, so, and I'm sorry, this goes on for a long time. So, sorry, but we got more speech, and someone else is talking? Oh no. Toast? Oh, there's a lot more. No. I'll try to speed it up, but anyway, I'll try to speed it up. But I got time. So, no, I am not done. So now, we made it down the steps. People said we wouldn't. Spencer married his sister, which sounds weird. It does sound weird. And now I'm here, standing here, you know, giving this speech at the reception. And it's really, I think a lot of parents feel this about, you know, they look at their daughter, they look at their son, and they go, you know, where did all the time go? That we're here now today. And, you know, Madeline, and I should say a lot of people don't know. I mean, the answer is, where does all the time go? You don't know. But Madeline had an answer for this. When she was little, she had written a story. And I really don't remember the story at all. I only remember this one line from the story. And so I have to make up some context to it. And the story was basically, there was a little boy, and then he was a bigger boy. And something happened in the middle. So the line in between is little boy, and then moths went by, and then there was a big boy. Now these are moths, like butterflies, moths. So I'm reading this story and I'm going, there's a little boy, some moths went by, and then there was a big boy. And I thought, what is it with the moths? Where did the moths come from? Are these magical moths that turn people? And then someone looked at me and said, you know, if you add an N to moths, you have months went by, which made a lot more sense. Months went by and she got older, but it wasn't nearly as interesting a story. And so that stuck with me, that moths and the passing of time, moths went by, see? And so after that, Madeline and I would go, how long was that ago? I don't know. I think a lot of moths went by between now and then. And so that was our little joke. And it was a couple of weeks ago that I was sitting on my sofa in the living room and the lamp was on and it was dark and there was a moth that was kind of up there flying around the light and bouncing along the window. And it made me think about today. Every time I see a moth, well, not maybe not every time, but every time I see a moth, I think of the passing of time, and I think of my daughter getting married, and I think of my little girl growing up, and part of me says, damn you, moth. But the better part of me says that it's great to see two children grow up, become adults, find each other, and marry. So if moths have anything to do with that, so be it. Now, the last thing let's go on. So, Rob, I want to tell you a little bit about your future, because we have this from Madeline's life here. My life, cleverly titled autobiography by Madeline called My Life. She had a section where she focused on chapter 3, My Future. Madeline, for Rob, I want to tell you that you're going to live in a 27-room house. It just seems her favorite. Now, at this point, Madeline was going to be an interior designer. So she switched over, and it might have been a good thing, because her favorite room in this house was a bathroom surrounded. No. It was a pool-surrounded bathroom. Now, for some of you who don't know what a pool-surrounded bathroom is, that's a bathroom surrounded by a pool. I don't really get that. It seems like, oh God, I gotta go swim for it again. Seems like not the best idea. But that was her favorite room. She also had a full-size gymnasium in this house, basketball gym. So she knew, maybe she knew it was you, Rob, a basketball guy. But I'm not so sure. I think on the cover of the book is Madeline laying on the floor, gym floor, with her own pom-poms and basketball. So I think maybe she was just envisioned herself throughout life going down to the gym and cheering. You know, as I'm in an over 40 cheered lead now, you know. We're pretty competitive. Yeah. But you had a few other predictions in there when you were 60, and I thought this was really vague, but literally in this book, when she's 60, she goes, I might be cooking dinner. And I thought, well, you might be. You might be. And when you were 80, and I think this is this, she goes, when I'm 80, I might be taking care of my husband. Right. So that would be 52 or 53 years from now. And Rob, so you're going to live, that's pretty good. 80's not bad. That's pretty good. And you're going to be there. And Rob, you might say at that point, geez, where, you know, I think back to today and you might think, where's all the time gone? And Madeline's going to look at you and say, well, that's a lot of moths have gone by. So if this speech has a point or purpose, and I'm not sure it has yet, but if it does have a point or purpose, Rob, it's really for this. It's really for me to welcome you into our family. It gave me great personal pride. It gave me great personal pleasure and pride to walk my daughter down the steps without falling. And give her to you. Because I know you are going to be, you're a good person, you're gonna be a great husband for her, and I feel so great about that. And I wanna welcome you into our family, and I'm gonna speak on behalf of all of our family, for the Teppies, for Yvonne, for Grandma Kate, for Terry and Ted and Marilee and Tina and Ron and Candy, and all your cousins and relatives, I don't even know their names. All the Maglianos, all of them to welcome you into our family. So please accept that. Thank you. I have to introduce Chanel and Veronica. The new music act, Chanel and Veronica.
Guys, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Veronica. I'm one of Maddie's oldest friends. Maddie, I'm honored to stand by your side today, above all days, and on behalf of myself and all the bridesmaids. Louder? Okay. On behalf of myself and all the bridesmaids, I want to tell you how lovely and radiant you are today, and how happy we are to share this moment with you. Speaking of this wonderful weekend and this event, regardless of the wind and the weather, let's give a round of applause to Yvonne, Tim, Sherry, and Cam for putting on a beautiful weekend. So I'm gonna take us all back to 2004, which is the year that I met Maddie. When I first met Maddie, she had brown hair. She wore Hurley skateboard t-shirts. And she wore jeans that were a little bit too big for her. I cannot believe that it's been 14 years. I was a freshman, she was an eighth grader. I'll never forget the patch of woods in between my neighborhood and Maddie's driveway where Chanel actually introduced me to Maddie. This was the beginning of many nights of sneaking out and meeting at 1 a.m. to hang out past our curfew and hurry home before our parents woke up. Over the last 14 years, Maddie's fashion sense has dramatically improved, and she has taught me a lot about friendship and loyalty. I think I can say for all of Maddie's friends that you want to come directly to Maddie when you want to have a good time, when you want to be cheered up, or when you want to just lay on the couch and eat pizza or Skyline and do absolutely nothing. We've had so many happy memories over the last 14 years, and quite frankly, there's too many to name, but of all the great memories, the fondest one I will now have is watching you guys get married. Rob, thank you for making our girl the happiest and always keeping her on track. You're a hyper-competitive Kemps and Euchre player, and you have the best sense of humor. You keep Maddie grounded, and you give her the love and adoration that she deserves. I love seeing how your relationship has evolved over the years. You make each other better, and I'm so happy that you found each other, and mainly because it brought Walter into my life. And now I'm gonna transition over to the girl that had introduced me to Maddie originally.
Madeline, Rob.
Hi everyone. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Chanel, and I am one of Madeline's oldest friends. It all started on the bus in first and second grade. This tiny little thing came bouncing on the bus, all smile, and sat down next to me. She introduced herself and said, "Hi, I'm Madeline, E before the I." She really did say that. "Hello, Madeline." She told me that she liked my Winnie the Pooh backpack, and I told her that I loved her purple Rugrat overalls. And that was that. Anyone who has spent more than 5 minutes around us has probably heard a story or two from the last 22 years. We're sorry, we can't help it. From saving worms on the sidewalk, playing caveman in the woods, to being roommates in college. Through all of the many stages of life, no matter how many things have changed, I know I will always have my girl Maddie by my side. I say all of that to say this. We have been through every stage of life together thus far, and as amazing as all those memories are, nothing compares to the memories I've made with both Maddie and Rob. It was easy to tell very early on that this was our guy. For starters, check out that flow. Excellent debater, and thank God for his time management skills. I could not have dreamt up a more perfect match for our girl. I think I speak for the entire room when I say that he won us all over right away. I remember when we were very young, we said that we would be standing by one another on this day. And here we are. Maddie, Bob, I admire your love. Each and every one of us in this room is lucky to have you in our lives. I cannot wait to see what the future has in store for you. I love you both
so much. Now I want you all to raise your glasses and join me in a toast. We're gonna celebrate love and friendship, and we're celebrating what you guys have in each other, a best friend, someone to challenge you, and a partner for life. Cheers, guys. We love you.
Cheers, baby. Me too.
And now, Joe, Rob's brother.
Hello. For those, hi, I'm Joe, obviously. For those that don't know me, I'm Robbie's older brother, and he wants me to hold the microphone closer to my face, I guess. Yeah? So I had a couple words here written that I'm just going to scrap because of all the craziness here. I had some extremely funny jokes that I'll spare you from. They were going to work in organically here. It's just the wind. What did we call it? The wind storm event? Kind of changed my plans here, the event. And I know there's a couple more speeches yet to come, some funny stories of the two of them. Individually and together, so I'll leave the storytelling to the next speakers here. I don't have any stories prepared. Sorry. So I just wanted to say a couple words about the couple here. Robbie, as your older brother, it was really amazing to watch you mature and grow into the fine young man that you are today. It really was. I'm sure you learned it all from me. But it's been great to watch you grow up. Maddie, you're cool, you're beautiful, you're perfect for Robbie. I'm so happy you guys found each other. I really am. I am gonna turn to the notes for this part. Maybe if I can find my place here. Yeah, as a couple, you're not only a very beautiful couple, but we all can tell that you make each other very happy. And I came across a quote the other day that I think pretty much sums up this event here, if I can find it. Which I can't. Sorry. Here it is, right in front of me. So this is a quote from Mark Twain, and he said, "To get the full value of joy, you must have someone to divide it with." I really think you guys find joy in one another, and I can see that as we all can. So with that, I'd like everyone to raise a glass, and we'll have a toast to the couple. To Robbie and Maddie, I wish you guys many, many years of health and happiness. Love you both. Cheers.
Thank you.
He's not a talker. Reagan's up next.
All right, guys, I'll try to keep this short. In a way, tonight, this is kind of like a metaphor, right? This windstorm for marriage. Sometimes, you know, shit happens and your friends and family get you through it, right? So Rob and Maddie have told me that I'm not that funny and I don't understand comedy, so I just want to set your expectations appropriately. But first of all, of course, thank you to the Teppies so much for a spectacular evening, and to the Mizlas for last night, big rowdy party. I've had the blessing to get to know these families pretty well over the last 10 years. I've crashed quite a few family parties as a third wheel with these two. Cam's birthday party, lunches with Grandma Kate, dinners at the Teppies. I've been to them all. And Rob and Maddie truly are like family to me. So for those of you that I haven't met, I'm Reagan. Maddie and I met freshman year of college when we both joined Kappa, and I met Rob not very long after that. I lived with Maddie the entire time they were dating until eventually she left me for Rob. And even after she left me for Rob, we still talked very seriously about me maybe moving in with the two of them. And Rob said it would help save on the rent, so. But I never did that. But I love them both dearly and cherish the time that I lived with Maddie. I also like to take credit for introducing Maddie and Rob. It was sophomore year of college, and I had started hanging out over at Sigma Chi, and as you know, girls don't go anywhere alone, right? So I had to find a way to get Maddie to keep coming back over there with me, and I knew that the only way to secure her by my side was to drum up some love interest. So, very selfish on my part, but it did work out. So the way that they met kind of goes something like this. Maddie and I are standing in the hallway outside the kitchen at Sigma Chi, and we're just kind of peering into the room, and we're looking around, and we're like, no, not him. And I saw Rob across the room, and I'd gotten to know him pretty well over the summer before, and I was like, Maddie, what about that guy over there? And she was like, tall, cute, well-dressed. Okay, all right, let's do it. So we went over and weaseled our way into a beer pong game, and the rest is history. That's how it went. So I've spent quite a lot of time with these two, and one thing that I learned is that while they go about it in different ways, these two, they both know how to get what they want. And to speak about Maddie first, Maddie is so adorable and charming and lovable. And you just can't help but love the girl the minute that you're with her, no matter if she's just spilled something right all over your lap. Which she probably has, but you still love her. And a story about that, after freshman year, Maddie and I, with some other friends, we went to Europe for a couple weeks, and the rest of us, we're trying so hard to fit in. We want the French people to like us. And we're really trying hard. We're like, excusez-moi, parlez-vous anglais, everywhere we go. And no one gives us service, no one pays attention to us. Maddie walks in and she's like, bonjour, what's good here? And the guy's like, oh, here's a free croissant. I mean, really. But Rob has this talent too, it's just a little different. Rob, he's a keen negotiator. Otherwise known as he will argue with you until you're too tired and you give up. And truly, some of my favorite nights have been spent with Rob over long, long debates. But one good story for you is that one evening, Maddie, Rob, and I were coming home from somewhere in a cab, and Rob had started, we'll just call it a geopolitical discussion with a cab driver. I think it had something to do with Israel and Palestine. And the cab driver pulled the car over like he was ready to kick us out. He'd had enough of the debate. But Maddie swooped in and saved the day with that charm that we all know so well. But Rob's always good for a great debate. It's really one of my favorite things about him. So truly, they're both just such wonderful people you can't help but love, and they both give so much to each other. And over the last year, it's only confirmed even more for me that these two are the right thing. They've been so supportive of each other's jobs with Rob's work and Maddie's long nights in the sweatshop. And honestly, Rob is so supportive of Maddie's business that I'm surprised he hasn't started carrying a purse. They're excellent co-parents in raising their son, Walter, and it's hard to imagine that they could love a real human son more. And maybe they can. But no, I'm sure they will. The point is that these two both couldn't be any more lovable, and their love for each other couldn't be more obvious. It didn't take long in their relationship to recognize that this was the real deal. The rest of our friends had relationships that came and went, but so many people said to me over the years that these two are gonna make it, and I know they will. So to sum it up, one of my favorite Maddie and Rob traditions is that every year, Maddie would write Rob a poem on Valentine's Day. So in honor of that, I've written them a brief poem for their wedding. On Valentine's Day, 2012, Maddie wrote to Rob to express how she felt. She penned that her love is like a farmer loves his calf, and somehow that worked and gave Rob a laugh. So here we are now on the day of your wedding, and I have some words for you because I can see where it's heading. You'll both be best dressed, made for the runway, and you won't start a diet too strict to miss Skyline Sunday. Your days will be filled with laughter and joy and naps on the couch with Walter, your boy. Rob will keep strumming serenades on the guitar while Maddie takes her sweet, sweet time getting ready for the bar. And when it's time to celebrate, Rob will reach for a stogie. And Maddie will never be too serious to belt out some karaoke. Lastly, here's a few tips in case things get tough. Take it easy, be nice, and don't sweat the small stuff. Never cry over spilled milk or takeout or wine. It happens every day and turns out just fine. And if you get lost, take three lefts instead of a right. Anything, or take three rights instead of a left. Anything could happen, just like the time you met Hugh Hef. But what's most important is that you both stay so sweet, always support each other, and be honest about what you need. They say time goes fast when you're in love, so enjoy the ride. This is the shit people dream of.
Oh God, Rob. Really poor planning putting us last.
Hey everyone. Eric, this windstorm, what's a windstorm's favorite color?
I don't know, Ryan, please tell me.
It's blue.
All right, everybody, for those who don't know me, I am Eric.
And I'm Ryan Santoro.
And we know Rob from way back in the day, growing up in Madeira.
I know what everyone's thinking. We're gonna come up here, crack some jokes at Rob's expense, and then talk about how much we love Rob and Maddie together and how great they will be, and that's exactly what we're gonna do.
Now, when we first sat down to prepare for this speech, we thought it'd be good to, you know, first kind of brainstorm, write a couple things down, and, you know, and share it with each other. So we each wrote five things down, and oddly enough, we came up with the pretty much exact same list. Ryan, do you mind telling them?
So our five things we love about Rob. Number one. The Fairfax Skyline location. Number two, the Oakley Skyline location. Number three, the Montgomery Skyline.
No, but in all seriousness, Rob's an amazing guy. We love him so much. We care so much about him that we would even wear suits this blue for an entire 24 hours. So Rob's been one of my best friends since like way back in kindergarten. He's basically like the closest thing I've had to a brother all the way like growing up through high school. Now, if you don't know Rob back then, he was basically just skin and bones, which I still don't understand how that's possible given Mrs. Mizla kept the place stocked with Little Debbie's and Doritos and Skyline and Pop-Tarts, but somehow he stayed super skinny. But yeah, he was just like a quick 5-minute drive down Kenwood Road from me, and I swear I made that trip hundreds of times, felt like thousands, I swear, in those like 12 years that we were both living in Madeira. And I can remember those trips going over to the Mizla's house like it was yesterday, whether it was coming home with our parents from Madeira Dogs soccer practice, or playing, heading over to play paintball in the front yard, or drag racing my Volvo against Cam's red Cadillac on the way home from high school. I feel like those trips, it always led to a good time at the Mizla household, and I feel super lucky to have grown up with both Rob and the entire Mizla family. You know, Rob, I feel like we've grown up a lot since then. You probably more than me, it feels like, at this point. But I'm really proud of the guy you've become. You've always had this creative side, and it seems like you've really found someone who shares that interest with you, and I think that really speaks well for you guys into the future. Maddie, though we've only spent short times together and only been able to hang out in short spurts, I feel like it was pretty much immediate that I realized that you were going to be such a great fit for Rob. You're one of the easiest people I know, or easiest people to get along with, and you're always super positive. And you're always super positive, and I love that about you. But one thing that stands out to me is that you really allow Rob to be himself. Obviously, he's super stubborn. He's kind of quirky at times, but you know, you just really allow like him to be himself and to really stand out. So you know, I wish you guys happy, long, lovely life together. I'm really excited for you guys. I love you both, and I think Ryan wants to join in on this love fest, maybe.
Sure. When writing the speech, I think I look back at my friendship with Rob over the years. It was everything a storybook or Hollywood film would expect out of a friendship. We grew up down the street from each other. We went to the same high school as each other. When Eric went to his Ivy League equivalent college, Rob and I took our talents to UC. We lived together there, and now we live a few miles down the road in Mount Lookout. I mean, when you think about that, that's literally the plot of Superbad. Obviously, Rob's McLovin. But seriously, it's almost impossible for me to sum up all the memories I have. I wrote down a few short ones that mean the most to me. Rob was one of my first friends when I moved to Madeira in junior high from being homeschooled, so Rob was a great first friend. I'll never forget the junior high summers we spent at the Madeira Swim Club, jumping on Logan Abner's trampoline and killing terrorists on SOCOM Navy SEALs on PlayStation 2. In high school, we were teammates that one year when you played football. I think that you still regret playing. I'll never forget, it was our final game. There was a pass thrown. I was wide open about to catch a touchdown, and out of nowhere, Rob just comes and catches the pass and gets tackled, and that would have been my last high school career catch, and I obviously haven't forgotten about it. We would drink Miller Lights in high school. We would drink Four Locos. We would drink warm vodka. Pretty much anything Cam had in his liquor cabinet, we would drink. And it feels like we always got caught. We went to the same college, joined the same fraternity, and lived together for most of our collegiate years. But out of all those memories, I think the one that means the most and the one that I can remember the most is the night that Rob met Maddie. What I didn't know, though, I was writing the speech about my version of it. I didn't know that you guys actually pointed through the room and picked out Rob as the guy, because I'm pretty sure I was in that room, so I don't know what that says. I mean, I guess I do know what it says. Well, being there when Reagan introduced Maddie to Rob, I kid you not, though, like when you envision a couple meeting for the first time, that's exactly what it looked like. I saw Rob, a slightly tipsy Rob, meet Maddie, but you could tell, like, the way that Rob acted, the glow that he had on his face, you could tell that you guys were gonna be get together for some time. I think watching your guys' relationship through college was one of the most enjoyable things I've had in my life. You guys have meant so much to my life. I have loved and enjoyed being a part of your relationship. Maddie, you are one of the most congenial, selfless, down-to-earth people I've ever met. I think in all of my years knowing Rob, you are the perfect fit for him. And I'm so excited for you guys to be together. So thank you so much for letting us be a part of your special day, your life, and I think we all look forward to a few years down the road and stay in touch. So with that being said, let's get a toast. Don't be overserved by these bartenders. They'll overserve you if you're not careful. So let's go. Cam, where's that skyline at? I was so nervous.
And the next speech, no, I'm just kidding. I'm just gonna say something real quick. Honestly, thank you everybody for coming out tonight. Seriously, everybody who was holding down the fort over here, that was some serious willpower. Honestly, that was one of the coolest things I've ever seen. Thank you everybody for helping and everything you've done. We've got family in from California, Washington, Texas, Colorado, Michigan, Massachusetts, New York, literally everywhere. There's and Detroit, Utah. I don't know how I got those mixed up. There's even some West Siders made the drive out too. I know it's not a close drive, but honestly, like, it means the world to have all of you guys here with us tonight. You guys are all our family, and we have a massive family, obviously. So just know that, like, we're so happy to have everybody here celebrating our wedding together. Do you want to say anything? She doesn't want to say anything. All right, and I don't know what we're doing next, so I think we're gonna cut the cake.
special deluxe iPod request here. Here we go. I have no idea what this is. It's from his father. Is this not the right song? All right.
Thank you.
we are the Blue Water Kings.
When Rob and Maddie asked me to do a reading at their wedding, I told them I would be honored. And Maddie said that I could choose anything I wanted for the reading except not that verse in the Bible that said, wives obey your husbands. That I couldn't do. My daughter suggested I do that segment from Romans in the book of the Bible that said, where you go, I will go, and your people will be my people. But I felt that was overdone at weddings. So I got to thinking, and I remembered the times that I could see Rob and Maddie curled up on a sofa, pretending they were watching TV. And I thought in my mind, what might they be saying to each other? And that brought to mind one of my favorite hymns. So this reading is from this hymn, and this is what I can imagine Rob and Maddie saying to each other. Great is my faithfulness to you. You do not change over time. Your compassions do not leave you. As you have been, you forever will be. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature to witness my fulfillment and love. Your own dear presence cheers and guides me. You give me strength for today and hope for tomorrow. 10,000 blessings are mine, and more are to come. Morning by morning, all I have needed, you have provided. Great is my faithfulness to you.
So Maddie and Rob had probably a less than perfect wedding reception. And when I was with Maddie a month afterwards, and she was still so sad, I just said, we're going to fix this because that's what moms do, right? So what I want to say is, first of all, thank you all so much for coming. And I want some thanks to Funky, who went out of his way to accommodate us. Thank you. Reagan was my girl on the ground. I appreciate that. Thanks, of course, Yvonne and Tim for having a beautiful daughter and a beautiful reception. But what I want to say to my son and my daughter-in-law You all have given us a lot of reasons to be proud of you over the years. But October 20th, I was never so proud of two people in my life. The way that you handled what would have sent me jumping off a balcony with so much grace and so much poise, I can't tell you how proud I was of you, and that's why we're doing this for you. We all love you. So this is Rob's sister, Gina. She's going to lead us in a toast, and then we're going to do a little dancing, and then we're going to do a lot of dancing.
Okay, hi. That's a lot of people. Again, I'm Gina, Rob's, I used to say bigger sister, but older sister. Obvious reasons why there. Not as sentimental as my mom, but again, thank you all so much for coming out and helping me trick Rob. A quick story. This is not the first time I've ever tricked Rob, unfortunately for him. Let me take you back about 20 years to a game I like to call Bank. real fast, Rob and I used to play this game called Bank, where one of us, me, because again I'm older, would be the banker. This game was very simple. Rob and I would put our real combined money together, and I would manage our money, if you will, our real money, out of my room in a safe spot. And we then shared our money. But unfortunately, this bank only opened after Rob had a birthday or Rob had an occasion where he was given money of some sort. And I would manage his money for him, so I thought I was just being a nice sister, so hey. But that was the first time I tricked Rob, and it's been 28 years of tricking him since. He's flicking me off right now. But no, in all honesty, Rob has always been, I mean, from the get-go, he's been my sidekick, my little best friend, my go-to, my number one. So when he brought Maddie around 14, 15 years ago, we could not have been more happy. Love Maddie. She's the sister I've always wanted. Thank you all so much for coming out. We love them both. I mean, who doesn't love Rob and Maddie, right? So if you could just raise your glasses and to Rob and Maddie, Rob, Bob, and Mad Dog, and yeah, thank you all.
So we're going to try to have Maddie and Rob recreate their first dance very soon, but new on the scene is the best man, Joe Misla, just in from Memphis.
But I'm walking in Memphis. Walking with my feet 10 feet
with the white ball cap.
Walking in Memphis.
Joe literally drove straight from Memphis to come and see his baby brother. So thanks, Joe. Okay, have fun, guys.
Let me preface this by saying that we have not practiced this dance since October 19th. Is that what you're doing? Well, the day before, I mean. They're not going to play Shiver Shiver. Is that what they're going to play? Okay, here we go. We're gonna give this a shot.
You don't have to do the whole dance. Everybody missed it.
Shall we get intimate again? Now that you're dear to me. You are close to me.
Make a little noise for him, folks.